Belinda presents this unabridged recording of The Schoolmouse, written by Dick King-Smith and read by Rosemary Leach.
Chapter 1, in which Flora makes a start. Flora was a school mouse. Everyone knows that there are house mice and field mice and harvest mice, and everyone knows that mice who live inside churches are called church mice. So it's easy to guess where Flora lived. The school was a very old one, nearly 150 years old, in fact, and it stood in the middle of some fields. 42 children went to the school, infants and juniors, and about the same number of mice, fathers, mothers and children, lived permanently in its crumbly old walls and ceilings and dark cupboards and under its worn wooden floorboards. But of all these school mice, only one grew up to become interested in learning the same lessons as the children. That was Flora. It was as though Flora was destined to be a very special school mouse, for she was born on the first day of the first term of the new school year in a hole in the wall of the infant classroom. Immediately behind the teacher's desk, there was a cupboard let into the old whitewashed stone wall, and just above the doors of this cupboard, there was a small space between two of the stones. High up inside the cupboard, a hole had been gnawed so that a school mouse could run up inside and make its way into the space between the stones. From here, if it peeped out, it would have a fine view of the classroom, including a close-up of the top of the teacher's head a couple of feet below as she sat at her desk. On this particular morning, a particular school mouse did not peep out at the infant classroom, for it was much too busy giving birth to 10 babies, one of which was the infant Flora. All that day, the mother mouse lay in the hole in the wall and suckled her new pink naked children until school was ended and the children had gone home and the cleaning ladies had tidied up and the caretaker had locked up. And the old school was empty of all life, save for the jackdaws nesting in the chimneys and the school mice. Then, at last, easing herself off her sleeping babies, the mother scuttled down into the cupboard and out between its rickety old doors that never quite shut. One jump landed her on top of the teacher's desk and another onto her chair, down the leg of which she clambered. In the middle of the classroom floor, she could see, was another mouse, pottering about, whiskers twitching. He was searching for any little bits of anything eatable that the children might have dropped and the cleaning ladies missed. What a husband, thought the mother mouse, whose name was Hyacinth. Here am I, brought to bed of 10 children, and he's not even been to visit me. And sharply she called out, Robin? Hyacinth's husband was an untidy fellow whose coat always looked badly in need of grooming. He had lost a part of one ear in a fight, and the end of his tail in a trap, and the other school mice called him Ragged Robin. Now, at Hyacinth's summons, he came hurrying towards her. Hyce! He cried, for it was his habit always to address his wife thus, to rhyme with mice. Hyce, my love, I haven't seen you all day. No, said Hyacinth shortly. And you seem to have grown thinner, look, more slender, that is, said Robin. Yes, said Hyacinth. Have you been on a diet? No, said Hyacinth, I have simply lost weight. How? Said Robin. You had better come and see. Up the leg of the teacher's chair they went, and onto the desk top, and up inside the cupboard to the hole in the wall. There, said Hyacinth, and she could not keep a note of pride from her voice. All all yours. All mine, said Ragged Robin, and he could not keep a note of anxiety from his voice. Did she expect him to look after this swarm of ugly little pink hairless monsters? He had never had children before. I mean, what did fathers do? What do I do, Hyacinth? He asked nervously. Do? Said Hyacinth. You don't do anything. It is I who have to suckle them and keep them warm and keep them clean and bring them up to be good mousekins. All you need to do is admire our 10 children. Are they not beautiful? Without doubt, said Robin doubtfully. 10, did you say? Yes, as like as peas in a pod. But here, though she was not to know it for quite a while, Hyacinth was wrong. Alike in looks and size the babies might be, and no one watching them as their hair grew and their eyes opened and they began to crawl about the nest could possibly have told one from another. Yet, among them, as the weeks of term went by and they grew into active, nimble mousekins, was one, a female, who was to develop into the world's most educated school mouse. Well, that one, of course, was Flora. Now, whether, in fact, Flora was more intelligent than her 9 brothers and sisters, we shall never know. What is certain is that she was more inquisitive. From an early age, Flora liked to poke her nose into everything. Everything interested her, and why was her favourite word. Why did they live in a school? Why was the school sometimes full of people, mostly small, and why sometimes empty? Why did all these small people and some big ones come to the school? Why did the little ones look at lots of pieces of paper all joined together with pictures on them and strange black marks and squiggles on the white paper? Why did they hold what looked like thin pieces of wood in their little fat hands and make other black marks on other sheets of paper? All these things Flora observed, for she alone looked outward from the hole in the wall above the teacher's desk in the infant classroom. Always during the school day, Hyacinth and the other 9 kept well back inside, out of sight. But Flora crouched at the dark mouth of the hole, watching everything that went on with the greatest curiosity. Whether she inherited this thirst for knowledge from her matter-of-fact mother or her somewhat scatterbrained father, we shall again never know. But it did not take her long to discover that neither of them knew the answers to all her many whys. It was up to her to find out. She began the very next morning. One thing that Flora already knew was that sometime in each day, each child would bring with it one of those joined-together wads of paper, put it down on the desk and open it. Then the teacher would point at the black marks on the paper, one after another, from left to right, and the child would make different noises. But day after day, Flora peered down intently, longing to make sense of whatever was going on. But her eyes, though clearly seeing the shape of the printed words on the pages of the books, could not interpret them. And her ears, though clearly hearing the child as it read, could not understand the sounds it made. Then at last one morning came the great breakthrough that was to make all the difference to Flora's future. She was watching attentively, as usual, while a little girl stood beside the teacher with her book. She was a very little girl, just beginning to learn to read, and the book was a very simple one. On each page was a large coloured picture, and below the picture, a single word. The first picture, for example, was of a round red fruit, and below it was written A-P-P-L-E. Flora had never seen an apple, so the sound the child made meant nothing to her, nor had she yet in her short life set eyes on a loaf of B-R-E-A-D, or, mercifully, a C-A-T. or on any of the other objects shown as the pages turned, until the child reached M. There was a picture that Flora immediately recognised, and below it were five little black marks on the paper. Five marks like these. M-O-U-S-E. "Well," said the teacher. "Mouse," said the child. And in Flora's tiny brain something clicked. And once again she stared hungrily at those five little black marks. "Mouse," she said to herself. Flora had begun to read. Chapter 2, in which Flora reads a story. The five letters, each so different from its fellows that made up that first word, were the key to Flora's progress. As she crouched in the hole in the wall, eagerly watching the children reading from their various books, she began to recognise those strangely shaped black marks. This was especially so when one of them was the first letter of a word that meant something to her. The shape M, for example, stood not only for mouse, but for mother. O was for owl, and though Flora had never seen one, Hyacinth had told them all what made that melancholy nighttime cry outside the old school. And U began a number of common words like us and up and under, while S was for lots of things mice did, like squeak and scurry and sniff, and E for another, most important one, eat. One word led to another, and since Flora not only looked but also listened as each of the infants read to the teacher every day, she began to match the shape of the word on the page to the sound that came out of the child's mouth. And never was there such an attentive, hard-working school mouse as Flora. As Christmas approached at the end of that first term of Flora's life, something else happened which was to further her education. One weekend, a time when the school mice had the place to themselves, Hyacinth called a family conference in the cupboard in the infant classroom. Ragged Robin had taken little notice of his 10 children, being too busy, like all his fellows, searching for food. But now, summoned by his wife, he gave the mousekins his full attention. "I say, Hyce," he cried, "I must congratulate you, my love. You have reared 10 splendid children. How strong and healthy they look." "They are," said Hyacinth. "Say hello to Daddy, children." "Hello, Daddy," chorused the mousekins, all except Flora, who said, "Hello, Father," a word that she had recently learned. "And now," said Hyacinth, "say goodbye." "To Daddy?" said one of the children. "To both of us," said Hyacinth. "It is time you all went to seek your fortunes out in the great wide school." "Yippee!" cried 9 of the mousekins, and away they went, out of the cupboard, onto the desk, onto the floor, and out through one or other of the doors of the infant classroom, rejoicing that they were infants no longer. Only Flora remained. She did not at all wish her education to be interrupted. "Mother," she said, "please can I stay?"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.